The greatest disruptor of all time is actually COVID-19. Because of limited mobility, people are also not being able to go to physical branches, etc. So it further accelerated the adoption of consumers of digital channels. We are now being able to provide the services needed by our citizens, by our consumers.
Mobility will be key to recovery because we have relaxed some of our quarantine methods, no? And we have allowed more transportation to come out. That's going to prove to be better for demand. If we do follow the health protocols, the ability of people to move around will likely contribute better to growth.
The greatest disruptor of all time is actually COVID-19. Because of limited mobility, people are also not being able to go to physical branches, etc. So it further accelerated the adoption of consumers of digital channels. We are now being able to provide the services needed by our citizens, by our consumers.
Thank you.
mobility will be key to recovery because we have relaxed some of our quarantine methods now, and we have allowed more transportation to come out. That's going to prove to be better for demand. If we do follow the health protocols, the ability of people to move around will likely contribute better to growth.
Over 3,700 families displaced by Tropical Depression Agaton. We'll get updates from our correspondents on the ground. We'll also speak with Leyte Governor Leopoldo Dominico Petilla on how Agaton has affected his province. The Philippines is poll body looking to add more voting precincts to the economy. Hi, I'm Carmina Constantino. Dateline Philippines begins right now. Thanks for joining us. For those of you watching us on YouTube and on Facebook, glad you could join us today. We begin with the latest on Tropical Depression Agaton. It has already displaced over 3,700 families across the Visayas and Mindanao. Malacanang says 201 barangays have been affected by the bad weather. Authorities are still assessing reports of casualties related to Agaton.
Currently, we have received the report, and this is undergoing validation. The death of one person dyan po sa Mindanao area as a result of a drowning incident due to the flooding situations encountered. We also have two reports of injuries in Mindanao due to the flooding situation. There are some reports this morning na may additional daw tayong kababayan na nasawi, but we're still waiting for the official recount and report coming from our regional counterparts.
A state of calamity declared in Cebu City due to Agaton. While Cebu City is currently not under any wind signal warnings, rains brought by Agaton have already triggered floods and landslides in several areas. Mayor Michael Rama says they're monitoring a possible high tide, which may exacerbate the flooding. He is also appealing to the Commission on Elections to exempt calamity funds from the election spending ban.
I don't think this should be too much of being strict. Even those that have been affected by Odette, we apologize because of community restriction. There are still ayudas that we need to give to those that we already have validated. In fact, $1 million worth, 20,000 beneficiaries. We have filed our petition, but I wish petition should not be necessary because these are all facts. There are figures that houses are still to be attended to. There are figures that there are beneficiaries that cannot be receiving their benefits because of the restriction.
The poll body, meanwhile, says local governments only need to file the necessary petitions for the distribution of calamity aid. COMELEC Commissioner George Garcia adds they can even inform their local offices ahead of time so that the aid can be distributed immediately.
We are fully aware of the presence of calamity and there are certain calamity funds allotted for this kind of incidents. But if only the LGUs, without particularly naming the LGUs, can immediately go to the Commission election, file something with the COMELEC, we can expedite everything. We can even forego hearing on the case, and based on the evidence available and what we can always take cognizance of the fact that indeed there was a storm, there was a calamity, then we can immediately grant any request for expenditure. Perhaps initially what they can do is, this is just an advice, just inform our local COMELEC. Inform our local COMELEC that we wanted to help our constituents. Medyo wala na sila, wala na silang makain, wala silang mainom. We would like to help them pending the filing of a formal petition with us.
Let's get the latest on the ground in Cebu from our correspondent Annie Perez. She joins us now. Annie, what more can you tell us?
Yes, Carmina, right now the Philippine Coast Guard is investigating the extent of damage brought about by a ship that was the searches at Consuelo Port, Camotes Island, Cebu yesterday. This is MV Mikamari 1 of Jomalia Shipping Lines that has a trip to from Camotes Island to Danao City Port. According to Commander Alvin De Galea of PCG Cebu, the ship was anchored in Consuelo Port when it hit big waves and strong winds yesterday. That's why the incident happened. There are 14 crew members of the ship that were able to get off the ship right away when the incident was happening, and they have not noted anybody who was hurt or was injured from the incident. But they are wary because the ship has about 5,430 liters of diesel and 68 liters of lube oil inside. So that's why they are trying to look for ways to stop the oil spillage after the incident. Meanwhile, Carmina, there are still a lot of trips that have been suspended due to the typhoon Agaton. In Gerona Private Port in Tabuelan, Cebu, if you have seen the pictures, it's still filled with water. It's still flooded by the heavy rains that have occurred here in Cebu. And in Hagnaya Port, there are a lot of passengers who still wanted to cross to Bantayan Island, but trips are temporarily suspended, so the local government unit have asked the passengers to move to the evacuation center, which is the nearest school, and it is Hagnaya Elementary School, where they will be staying for the day, for the night, until the trips resume here in Cebu. Meanwhile, all the other disaster responding teams of the local government units are making their assessment now that the weather here is not as bad as over the weekend. The rains have stopped, but there's still wind and cloudy skies. So we're still trying to get a feel, Carmina, of all the damage and all the assessments that have occurred over the weekend and today. And that's the latest from Cebu, Carmina.
Yes, Annie, just one question before you let you go. You said that the weather now is sort of cooperating, no torrential rains, winds have died down. But is it cooperating enough so that authorities can continue to work on the oil spill and contain it at the soonest possible time, Annie?
We haven't got the recent word from the Coast Guard, Carmina. They're still continuing their investigation and trying to stop the oil spillage. But we have a filler from the Philippine Coast Guard. We talked to Commander Alvin Galea. He said that the weather is fine for them, but they are not doing underground work as of the moment. They are still in meetings as well as trying to take shelter of all the stranded passengers across the different ports in Cebu. So on top of the environmental concern, they're also still trying to alleviate the concerns of the passengers who went to the ports despite the difference and the consistent reminders of their shipping lines and the ports that trips are suspended because of weather conditions. So we hope that by the end of the day, Carmina, we can get an update from the PCG, and there would be not that much damage to the environment as to the oil spill that happened in Consuelo Port, Camotes Island. Carmina.
And also, Annie, on to the passengers now. Have authorities told you of any estimated duration of stay of the passengers before they're allowed to continue on with their voyage?
Carmina, they're still waiting also for clearance from PAGASA when they can actually continue the trips. Right now, some of the storm signal warnings have been lifted in some of the areas in Cebu. If I'm not mistaken, those are only under the northeastern part of Cebu from Liloan up to the tip is under signal number one. So they are trying now to coordinate with all the other shipping lines when they can immediately resume and if it's safe, because right now it's already noontime. Mm-hmm. Some of the vessels it's not safe to leave when it's nighttime, especially for the smaller ships. So maybe they can continue their voyage tomorrow or later this afternoon. So we're trying also to get a hold of PCG while they're doing all the coordination work with the different sectors and authorities. Carmina.
All right. And as you do that, continue to keep safe and take care. Annie Perez there joining us on the line. Thanks again, Annie. Back here in the studio, the town of Catiil in Davao Oriental, also under a state of calamity due to Agaton. An 83-year-old man there drowned due to a flash flood. The floods have subsided and evacuees have returned home, but at least one area is still isolated.
May mga minimal landslide naman po, sir, sa National Highway, pero nagawa naman po ng paraan. Na-deploy po tayo ng team with the help of the DPWH. Ang tinututukan po natin ngayon is yung isang area po sa barangay Maglahos kung naging island po as of this time kasi naputol yung naging isang access road nila.
Over in Davao de Oro, clearing operations have begun as the weather starts to improve. The province has also experienced heavy rains that caused flooding and landslides, which affected some municipalities. Local disaster officials say the province's agriculture sector is among those badly hit by Agaton.
Umabot na po doon sa production areas natin, no, that covers rice, corn, and even high value crops. Umaabot na po ito ng mahigit 100 million ang damage to these particular crops and production areas.
Officials said at least two people have died in Davao de Oro while another individual remains missing. The Interior Department focusing on helping local government units affected by Agaton. Interior Undersecretary Jonathan Malaya says the agency is ready to assist in rescue and rehabilitation efforts. He also says the Interior Department has activated emergency operations centers to address the concerns of LGUs.
Bago pa po dumating itong bagyong Agaton ay na-activate na ng DILG yung aming emergency operation centers. At meron po din kaming regional operation center para sa mga lugar kung saan paparating yung bagyo. So na-activate na at nakapag-issue na po kami ng warnings and advisory sa lahat ng mga LGUs na para palakasin yung kanilang disaster preparedness. Ngayon naman po ay nakikipag-ugnayan na kami sa NDRRMC. Tututok naman po kami sa rescue and rehabilitation immediately after matapos ng bagyo.
Parts of Leyte reeling from the effects of Tropical Depression Agaton. Let's get an update on the situation there. We're now joined by Leyte Governor Leopoldo Dominico Petilla. Governor, good afternoon to you. Thanks for joining us today. We appreciate you coming to the show. Welcome to the program.
Good afternoon, Carmina, and all the viewers. Good afternoon.
All right. So let's get on to the situation there in Leyte. How would you describe the situation there as we speak, Governor Petilla?
Well, definitely the floods that has caused. Kasi ang bagyong Agaton coming from the Pacific Ocean, it crossed central Leyte and then went to the northwestern part of the province and then mag-U-turn. I don't know kung nag-U-turn na, pabalik naman siya going towards, pabalik sa Pacific Ocean, going towards eastern Samar. And it's moving in a very slow pace. That's why the rains are not that heavy, but it's continuous. That's why it's caused a lot of floods, no? More than 100 barangays as of 1 a.m. today. More than 100 barangays were flooded in 19 municipalities of the 41 in Leyte. Most especially the hardest hits in the floods were Abuyog, Leyte, and Baybay City. We have 145 families in the evacuation centers, and we're still, and it's still a bit a challenge to deploy now because umuulan pa, but started deploying anyway.
At saka malambot pa yung lupa, Governor. Meron ho bang kayong areas na pinagtutuunan ng pansin dahil sa landslide prone areas po ito?
Yes, we have areas like ang Tacloban, Baybay, going to Baybay Road doon sa bundok ay hindi madaanan ngayon dahil may landslide doon. Tapos may mga iba tayong mga reports of landslide sa mga roads na mga nasira dahil sa landslides going to our interior barangays. And although we are still verifying this, we also have one barangay na tinamaan din ng mga flash floods and landslide doon sa Baybay City.
No? Governor, how prepared were you for the onslaught of Agaton?
Well, ang ano naman natin is normally ang people here are, it's not just the government, the local governments, but also the people are always ready considering na parat tayong tinatamaan ng mga bagyo. Take note, we're still recovering from ano, no? From Udet.
Correct.
Bagyong Udet.
Oo, yun nga yung pag-uusapan din natin ngayon because this is not your first storm during this pandemic. And we gotta talk about Udet. You're still reeling from that. So, paano ho kaya makaka-epekto to sa pagbangon ng probinsya niyo po? Gayong, you're still reeling from Udet and then eto naman si Agaton. How does this complicate things?
Well, the important thing is ang ating mga ang population natin can katulad nung nangyari sa Odette, no? Mostly we have mga farmers ang nandito, no? Nakapagtanim ka agad, no? Nakabalik ka agad, no? Yun ang may importante, pero siyempre ito talagang nakadagdag ito sa hirap ng pag-recover natin sa Odette, itong Agaton ngayon na puro naman baha. Take note, ang Odette was so damaging, ang Odette. Maraming mga bahay na sinira talaga, mga bahay. Nagdi-distribute pa tayo ng mga yero, ng mga ano para sa mga bubong nila. Tapos ngayon yung Agaton. Ang Agaton naman is more on the floods rather than destruction sa mga houses. Mm-hmm. Mabuti na lang. But nonetheless, yun, we'll try to prepare lagi. And this, there are some barangays now the first time na binabaha.
No? And what would you attribute that?
I think yung weather natin seems to be changing. No? I mean, this is already April. Normally, ang April natin dito sa Leyte is very, very hot. You don't have to do anything. You just sit there, papawisan ka. Pero ngayon, this is totally different ng April ngayon na talagang since I think last week, no? Last week, maulan na dito. Tuloy-tuloy ang ulan. So I
think dun po sa areas na sinabi nyo na traditionally po hindi naman binabaha, aside from just the weather, is there urbanization happening in the area as well? Construction activities maybe that have contributed to why these floods are happening now?
Well, these are not a lot. Ay, siguro meron tayo, no? Yung, for example, may mga poblasyon dito like Palo Leyte. Although hindi siya binaha ngayon, pero ang town na yan is prone din sa baha. Ilang beses na binaha ang town proper. No? Pero ngayon, wala siyang baha. No? Meron namang ibang mga lugar na hindi natin inaasahan na binaha naman. Lalo na nga na ang impact dito is more on the south western side of the province of Leyte. Usually, ang tinatamaan talaga ng mga baha natin dito sa eastern side ng province.
Mm-hmm. And because of this, how are you going to sort of tweak your response and your disaster preparedness, given that as erratic as Agaton is now, it seems as if by the way you described it to us, the effects on your province have become erratic as well. Hindi mo na sasabihin na basta ulan lang or basta baha lang. Iba-iba na po ang nangyayari sa probinsya ninyo, Governor.
Mm-hmm. Yes, I think just like what we did after Yolanda, no, we have redrawn everything on ating disaster preparedness, ang ating mga pag-improve natin ng ating resiliency ng ating mga communities, no. For example, meron tayong mga barangay sa Yolanda na hindi inaabot talaga ng baha yan, pero natamaan ng storm surge. So na ang policy natin doon, kung may evacuation, hindi na sila mag-evacuate within their barangay. So, pupunta na sila sa ibang lugar para mag-evacuate. Parang those are some of the adjustments. And then, plus syempre, ang mga infrastructure na inaano natin, dinidevelop natin to help mitigate ang impact itong weather na to. So, now, we will also definitely do that, no? Review. And I think we need to be more scientific sa para mas ma-predict pa natin ang impact ng mga calamities.
But you can do all that, Governor. But if you don't get to curb the rampant illegal logging in your area, then this is all going to be for naught. What are you doing exactly to curb that? I mean, these are your constituents. They're getting affected by floods, which weren't happening before, and now it's happening. And it's because of illegal logging in your area.
Well, not necessarily. No, not necessarily. Meron tayong mga ganun, pero it's hindi na laganap, no. We have been planting mga trees, no, sa ating mga meron tayong mga working with the NGOs, no, at saka sa ibang government agencies to replant. Take note, we lost mga 8 million coconut trees from Yolanda. No, we lost those, no? So
yeah.
we have been replanting ever since, no.
Mm-mm.
Yun naman ang ano natin.
But how would you explain reports that even as recent as 2020 illegal logging continues to be rampant in your province?
Come again.
How would you explain the fact that as early as very recent as year 2020, there have been reports that illegal logging continues to be rampant in your area?
Yes, we actively meron tayong mga barangays. Ang ginawa natin ngayon is ang barangays, we support the barangays sa kanilang pagpantay. Kasi minsan may mga malalaki rin na mga big companies doing that, mga illegal logging. And then we even employ the support of the Philippine Army kung doon ito sa ating mga deep forests sila naggagawa niyan. No? Pero definitely we don't tolerate that dito sa province of Leyte.
Tell us about the challenges though. How are you not able to stop it completely?
Maraming factors eh. Maraming factors talaga. Ang ano natin talaga, what is important now, it's meron namang mga improvements natin nakikita in some areas. Kung ang community mismo, they become the first responder. Not necessarily the responder, ano, but, you know, coordinate with us, coordinate with the Philippine National Police or the Philippine Army. No? Pag merong ano, katulad sa insurgency na nangyari sa Leyte, no? If somebody comes here, ang mga tao natin sa barangay, they right away coordinate with the Philippine Army. So hindi na sila pumunta talaga dito. It's good, it's a bit risky na sa kanila pumunta dito sa Leyte.
But going back to illegal loggers, Governor, how could they be so brazen in their activities in your area? Bakit po ang lakas ng loob nila?
I don't know, no? Siguro kasi mayroong mga armado dito. Oo, mga armado dito, so tinatakot din nila yung mga taga barangay. So ang ano naman natin, pag di-report nila dito sa atin sa probinsyan, no? At saka sa Philippine Army, we take actions right away. Meron tayong mga nahuli na mga chainsaws, may mga ano. No, hinuhuli natin 'yan, no? Minsan nga pag kaya na ng barangay, hulihin na lang nila. Sila na humuhuli, pero pag hindi nila kaya kasi medyo mas matapang, mas malaki, they really contact us, and then pati yung ating RB at saka PNP. And then we take action right away. So kailangan din natin talaga natin ang support ng ating mga communities dito.
Just one question on this topic before I let you go on that. You take action right away, yet it continues to be rampant and your constituents are suffering for it. How does that make sense?
Well, siguro lang kailangan natin paigtingin pa. No? Definitely, we need the cooperation ng ating mga mamamayan, lalo na doon sa bundok. No? If there are mga nag-aano dyan, illegal logging, they have to report. They have to let us know, no, so that we can take action.
Let's talk about what happened recently, Governor Petilia. The Petilia clan, very powerful clan, one of the most powerful clans there in your province, shifting allegiances once again, and this time to Marcos Jr. supporting his bid for the presidency. Tell us, how is this a principled move and not a move for political survival?
Well, definitely, kung taga-Leyte, then it's almost definite na bibigyan niyang priority ang taga-Leyte, kung sino ang taga-Leyte na candidate. And definitely, if the LGUs will not align with the national government, then nothing will happen. Even if you pour in a lot of billions of pesos of funds, pero kung hindi nagko-cooperate ang local governments at saka yung national government, hindi nagtatrabaho as one. So a lot of money will be put into waste.
But that's the old way of thinking. That's the traditional way of doing things. Now that you have the Mandanas-Garcia ruling, which seeks to be, you know, the aim is really for a transformative country here by way of LGUs, you wouldn't be needing that connection anymore to the seat of power. You yourself will be able to transform your province because of this Mandanas-Garcia ruling.
Well, Mandanas, yes, it may still not be enough, no? Ang Mandanas. In fact, nagko-compute na tayo ng mga LGUs ngayon. Nagko-compute na sila ng mga kailangan gastusan based sa mga national programs na i-devolve dito sa local government, ang madadagdag ng mandanas ay kulang pa. No? Kulang pa na funds yan. No? So we still really need to the support ng national government. For example, if we get hit by, for example, ano, Simbaco, wag naman manyari ulit, yung Yolanda. No? Yolanda was around 31 billion ang damage sa Leyte. No? So definitely kung 31 billion on a budget of 4 or 5 billion ang province of Leyte, definitely hindi yan makakayanan ng ano ng Leyte lang.
Mm-hmm. No? But during the time... But during the time of Yolanda, you were also allied with the Liberal Party, correct?
Yes.
And did you get the funding that you needed at that time?
Not necessarily binigay sa province.
So what makes you think that this time around it will work?
Yung alin?
Yung pag-sanib puwersa po kay Marcos Jr. Because that was your argument a while ago, Governor.
Well, definitely kung ano tayo this can also work. Ang Yolanda naman was a very fast recovery para sa atin naman. It worked well naman ang kung anong whatever transpired yung Yolanda. Parang ano naman, parang it worked well for us. Naka-recover naman tayo mabilis in less than 2 years, no? That was the fastest recovery, no? So what? Now because also madali sa amin noon because we were aligned with the administration.
All right, but then you said a while ago it still wasn't enough. But let's leave that topic aside and
What I was saying is yung mandanas.
Uh-huh.
Yung mandanas, there will be instances that it will still not be enough, no? Lalo na pag tinamaan tayo ng major catastrophes, just like Yolanda.
Governor, how concerned are you about how people think of the Petilla clan, given the recent history? Jumping from the Liberal Party, going to PDP Laban, now pledging allegiance to Marcos Jr., that this sort of gives the people an impression that you're loyal only to your family and not to anyone else.
No, not to our family, but to the people of Leyte. What we want here to do is what is best para sa province of Leyte. Take note na ang Leyte, ang province of Leyte has been hit with several unfortunate events, no? Especially kahit ang Region 8 natin is before Yolanda, we are the second poorest region. Now we are fourth, no? Nag-improve na tayo to fourth, no? So parang ano, no? Parang it's not loyalty to the family, but you know, ang tao. I mean, that is what democracy is all about. Is ano ng tao, ano ang hinaing ng tao, then we have to address that. I think that's our job.
And we're going to have to leave it at that. Leyte Governor Leopoldo Petilla, Governor of Leyte, thank you so much for joining us today. Really appreciate you coming to the show. Take care. Keep safe.
Thank you, Carmina, and magandang hapon sa ating lahat.
We're going to take a break now. Up ahead, the Commission on Elections looking to add more polling precincts in Hong Kong after a chaotic first day of overseas absentee voting there. Dateline Philippines will be right back. Stay with us here on ANC.
mobility will be key to recovery because we have relaxed some of our quarantine methods now, and we have allowed more transportation to come out. That's going to prove to be better for demand. If we do follow the health protocols, the ability of people to move around will likely contribute better to growth.
Greatest disruptor of all time is actually COVID-19. Because of limited mobility, people are also not being able to go to physical branches, etc. So it further accelerated the adoption of consumers of digital channels. We are now being able to provide the services needed by our citizens, by our consumers.
Back. You're still with Dateline Philippines here on ANC. Here's another look at our headlines this noon. Over 3,700 families displaced by tropical depression Agaton. The Philippines' poll body looking to add more voting precincts in Hong Kong after a historic day one of the overseas absentee voting there. COVID-19 booster jabs for 12 to 17 years old now awaiting the approval of Philippine regulators. And the Philippine Central Bank allays fears over the impact of Russia's invasion of Ukraine on the local economy. Let's get an update now on the track of tropical depression Agaton from ABS-CBN's resident meteorologist Ariel Rojas. Ariel now joins us via Zoom. Ariel, over to you.
Hi, good afternoon, Carmina. Agaton was downgraded from tropical storm to tropical depression earlier this morning. At 10 a.m., it was located over the coastal waters of Tanawan, Leyte, with maximum winds of 45 kilometers per hour near its center and gusts up to 60 kilometers per hour. It is presently almost stationary. Tropical cyclone wind signal number 1 remains in effect over southern Masbate, northern Samar, Samar, eastern Samar, Biliran, Leyte, southern Leyte, northeastern Cebu, including Camotes Islands, eastern Bohol, Surigao del Norte, and Dinagat Islands. At times, intense rains will still be expected in northern Cebu, northern Negros, Panay, Guimaras, Romblon, and Masbate. Scattered rains will also be experienced in Calabarzon, Mindanao, and the rest of Visayas, Mimaropa, and Bicol region. And this will continue until tomorrow or on Wednesday. Arca Pamilya will have to remain alert as widespread and serious floods and landslides still threaten these areas. And those traveling this Holy Week will have to brace stranding. Sea travel is not allowed in areas under signal number 1, while flights may be cancelled or postponed due to the inclement weather in southern Luzon, Visayas, and Mindanao. Some roads are also impassable due to either serious flooding or landslides. Metro Manila and Central Luzon will be mostly cloudy today with chances of light showers this afternoon. Meanwhile, the low pressure area offshore southern Palawan has already dissipated, and outside the Philippine area of responsibility, severe tropical storm Malakas continues to move closer to the PAR line. It was located 1,300 kilometers east of southern Luzon with maximum winds of 100 kilometers per hour and gusts up to 125 kilometers per hour. It is moving northwestward at 15 kilometers per hour. Malakas will enter the PAR later tonight or early tomorrow morning as typhoon and will be given the local name Bashang. And Malakas is unlikely to directly affect the weather in the country and will have a short stay inside the PAR. That's the latest on the weather. This is Ariel Rojas. Back to you, Carmina.
Thanks a lot, Ariel Rojas there. The Philippine Commission on Elections looking to add more voting precincts in Hong Kong after Filipinos there complained of a chaotic first day of overseas absentee voting. Hong Kong police even had to flag the long line in Kennedy Town Sunday over COVID concerns. Some Filipinos were also asked to cast their ballots on a different day. Currently, there are only 5 polling precincts in Hong Kong, despite the fact that the city has over 93,000 registered voters. KOMELEC Commissioner George Garcia says this issue will be addressed in their on-bank meeting this Tuesday.
Ang kaya lamang po nilang mapaboto sa loob ng isang araw ay 1,350. Hindi po talaga kayang i-accommodate yung buhos ng mga botante.
Actually, there are additional 5 more vote counting machines available to our post. There are 4 additional and 1 on standby basis. So there are actually 10 vote counting machines, but it's actually the decision of the post to establish only 5 precincts. By tomorrow, we will have our en banc meeting and surely it will be discussed and we will push for an increase in the number of precincts in order to allow more Filipino voters to vote. And number 2, not to offend the sensitivities of the Hong Kong authorities, especially that we are fully aware of the COVID-19 situation in the territory.
Overseas voting for Filipinos abroad also began in other parts of the world, among them Kuwait, Bahrain, Oman, Dubai, Jeddah, and Saudi Arabia in the Middle East, and the U.S., Taiwan, and Italy. The mixed mode of voting for Filipinos is being implemented in Italy, while those in Rome are voting by mail. Over in the U.S., the overseas absentee voting has begun, though preparations in some states have hit a snag. Our North America Bureau correspondent Steve Angeles filed this report.
We are technically at the beginning of the overseas voting period. However, we might not be getting any ballots anytime soon because, number 1, it is a by-mail-only vote here in the U.S., and number 2, some of the machines are delayed. Some consulates have not yet been able to do the final testing and sealing, such as New York. Los Angeles just did theirs on Thursday afternoon and began sending out their voter material this past couple of days. They're not expecting to get some ballots back in. San Francisco seems to have finished everything early, and they're all good and ready to go. So these consulates will also do some drop-in mail visitors to bring their ballots to their consulates. Beginning every Monday and Thursday, they will begin counting their ballots. America accounts for about 1.9 million overseas registered voters. However, historically, only about 17% have been able to cast their ballots. And some groups are showing some concern because they're unsure of if the election material will actually get here on time. But you know, for the most part, it looks like they will be beginning their counts soon.
Presidential candidates continued to campaign over the weekend. Francisco Isko Moreno de Magoso held a concert-like rally in his home turf, Manila, where he was joined by showbiz personalities on stage. Meanwhile, Leni Robredo supporters, including her daughter Aika, went house to house in Manila. This follows her major campaign rally in Pampanga, where an estimated 220,000 people attended. Overseas Filipinos backing Robredo also held events over the weekend. Senator Manny Pacquiao also booed voters in Manila. The Pac-Man was accompanied by wife Jinky as they campaigned in Tondo. Over in France, President Emmanuel Macron is projected to win the first round of the French elections, while his far-right rival Marine Le Pen is poised to come in second. This sets them up for a runoff on April 24th. While Macron is seen to head for a convincing first-round victory, opinion polls suggest the runoff could be much closer. His rival Le Pen is calling on non-Macron voters to join her in putting France back in order. Currently, 96% of the results have been counted. Macron has earned more than 27% of the votes, while Le Pen has around 24%. Over in Pakistan, Prime Minister Imran Khan is ousted from power after losing a no-confidence vote for his leadership. He was ousted over allegations of economic mismanagement and for mishandling the country's foreign policy. The vote was held past midnight after opposition parties brought a motion against him. The opposition secured 174 votes in the 342-member House in support of the ouster. The vote makes the former cricket star the first Pakistani prime minister to be ousted via a no-confidence motion. Parliament will convene Monday to elect a new prime minister. Opposition leader Shehbaz Sharif is expected to win the post. The Philippines recorded 277 new COVID-19 cases on Sunday, bringing the country's total to 3,681,000. The number of active infections stands at 28,380, the lowest since January 3rd. The drop in the number of daily cases and the easing of pandemic restrictions have pushed the country higher in the Bloomberg COVID Resilience Index. From 53rd place in February, the country moved up a few notches to 49th place in March. The Philippine Health Department says it's impossible to achieve herd immunity against COVID-19 at this time. Health Undersecretary Maria Rosario Vergeres says what the DOH is trying to achieve now is population protection. This means giving priority to the most vulnerable, such as senior citizens, people with comorbidities, healthcare workers, and children.
It's impossible for us to achieve herd immunity at this time because first, the protection from the vaccines are waning. So you cannot have that kind of protection for long. Second, we only have reached about 70% of those eligible in the population, meaning there are still sectors who are not vaccinated, like those less than 5 years old, are not eligible for vaccination yet.
Health authorities are now seeking the approval of the Food and Drug Administration for booster shots for children aged 12 to 17. DOH spokesperson Vergeres says they're also seeking the FDA's nod for a possible fourth dose for the general population. Once the amendments get released, the DOH will issue guidelines for the rollout of the additional jabs. Out of the 66 million Filipinos who are eligible for a booster shot, only about 12 million have received the additional jab. The death toll from a missile strike on a train station in Ukraine's Kramatorsk rises to 57. The casualties were civilians, mostly women and children, who were racing to flee the Donbas region ahead of Russia's offensive. 109 people were wounded in that attack, which Ukraine is blaming on Russia, but Moscow denied responsibility, saying the missile was Ukrainian. 6 weeks into Russia's invasion, Moscow has since shifted its focus onto eastern and southern Ukraine after stiff resistance thwarted its plans to swiftly capture Kyiv. Russian forces fired rockets into Ukraine's Luhansk and Dnipro regions Sunday. At least 5 people were injured while an airport was destroyed. Emergency workers are combing through another facility that was hit in search for any survivors. Pope Francis calling for an Easter ceasefire in Ukraine to pave the way for peace through real negotiations. During his Palm Sunday address, the pontiff denounced wars where defenseless civilians suffer heinous massacres and cruelty. While the people did not explicitly cite Russia's invasion, he has repeatedly denounced the war and the suffering brought upon innocent people. The appeal comes after Ukraine's President Volodymyr Zelensky said Kyiv is getting ready for decisive and important battles in the country's eastern portion. Though Zelensky also says there are parallel efforts to end the war through diplomacy. In business, Ukraine's economy likely to contract at a staggering pace this year due to Russia's invasion. Based on the World Bank's latest report, Ukraine's GDP will likely shrink by 45%. Excluding the impact of physical infrastructure destruction. That magnitude is still subject to a high degree of uncertainty, depending on the duration and intensity of the war. As for Russia, the World Bank expects its economy to contract 11% due to punishing financial sanctions imposed by the West and the U.S. and its Western allies. The Eastern Europe region comprising Ukraine, Belarus, and Moldova also forecast to show a GDP contraction of 30.7% this year due to shocks from the war and disruption of trade. The Philippine Central Bank, meanwhile, continues to allay fears over the impact of Russia's invasion of Ukraine on the local economy. BSP Governor Benjamin Diokno asserts the economic fallout from the war on the Philippine economy is limited for 3 reasons. The country's distance from the conflict area, its limited business links to both Ukraine and Russia, and its strong macroeconomic fundamentals. Diokno says Manila's combined exports to Moscow and Kyiv only amounted to $125 million in 2021 out of the $74 billion total exports last year. He adds, Philippine banks have no cross-border financial assets both with Russia and Ukraine. In terms of remittances, Diokno points out that less than 1% of the country's total remittances for 2021 were from Russia and Ukraine. Local pump prices set for a second straight week of rollbacks. Kerosene will see the biggest price cut of 3 pesos per liter on Tuesday. Gasoline prices will go down by 1 peso, while a liter of gasoline, make that diesel, will cost 35 centavos less. The decline follows lower trading prices at the world market last week after China extended its COVID-19 lockdown on top of Russian forces retreating from some key Ukrainian cities. Meanwhile, power rates set to go up this April due to higher generation charge. Meralco customers with a typical household consumption of 200 kilowatts per hour will see a 107 peso increase in their bill this month. Passengers continue to arrive at major transport hubs in the Philippines ahead of the Holy Week break. On Sunday, the Parañaque Integrated Terminal Exchange saw tens of thousands of travelers, and they are expecting more in the coming days.
Noong mga nakaraang araw, nakakaranas po tayo ng napakataas na bilang ng mga pasahero. Especially noong Friday, umabot po tayo ng around 103,000 passengers. So medyo mataas na po ito. Kahapon, bahagyang bumaba po ito, 83,000 lang po tayo. Pero inaasahan natin, pagdating po ng Tuesday, Wednesday at Thursday, papalo na naman po ulit ito sa mahigit 100,000.
The Ninoy Aquino International Airport also seeing an influx of travelers heading to provinces and tourist destinations this Holy Week since no lockdowns are imposed and most areas are now under COVID alert level 1. Over that Matnog port in Sorsogon, over 1,000 travelers were stranded due to tropical depression Agaton. After 2 years of the COVID-19 pandemic, Catholics in the Philippines can now commemorate Palm Sunday physically in churches. Many devotees have flocked to the Capo Church now that Metro Manila is under alert level 1. Street vendors were grateful for the crowds.
nakagaangkon, pakiramdam kasi dalawang taon na po mula ng pandemya. Mula nakapunta ko dito, ngayon lang po nakapunta ng Quiapo.
Papasalamat po kami dahil binigyan po kami ng kahit konting biyaya ng Diyos na para maghanap buhay. Kahit papaano makakuha po kami ng panggastos.
Many also attended the Palm Sunday celebration at the Manila Cathedral before the Mass started. The homeless Jesus sculpture was introduced and blessed outside the church by Manila's Archbishop Jose Cardinal Advincula. The Canadian ambassador to the Philippines, Peter MacArthur, also attended the Mass. In entertainment, a follow-up to a 2020 video game movie, an action thriller, and a science fiction comedy. Here is Manny, the movie guy's take on what's new in theaters.
Life or death situation.
It's a sequel that we didn't ask for. Sonic the Hedgehog 2, but don't yawn. This one is actually worth the wait. Jim Carrey returns as the big bad Dr. Robotnik, so does James Marsden as Sonic's adoptive father. And the manic charms of the first film are also intact. This is a sequel that kids will enjoy for its colorful energy, but it also has some quiet moments to give the film its heart. It's a gift for fans of the video game. And for that, Sonic the Hedgehog 2 gets 3 out of 4 blue hedgehog kisses. Also in theaters, Ambulance.
I like imagining visually how I can tell a story differently.
Action director Michael Bay returns for Ambulance, a heist film that has Yahya Abdul-Mateen II desperate for money for his wife's bills. He asks the help of his adoptive brother, played by Jake Gyllenhaal, their getaway vehicle, an ambulance.
I have a plan!
Lots of high-speed pursuits follow, but since this is a Michael Bay film, the guy who gave us the Transformers movies, there's a lot of candy-colored shots complete with slow-motion effects. But don't let those derail you from enjoying this non-stop action flick. The cast is inspired, the pacing is fast, and no one does kinetic visuals like Michael Bay. And for that, Ambulance gets 3 out of 4 J-Scene's kisses. And finally, we have Everything Everywhere All at Once. Move over, Spider-Man and Doctor Strange. We've found the rightful ruler of the multiverse, and it's Michelle Yeoh.
Multiverse.
Yeoh is Evelyn Wang, a struggling laundromat owner who finds herself in parallel universes. It's now up to her to learn the secret of the multiverse. From writers-directors known as the Daniels, Everything Everywhere All at Once benefits from its smart writing and the great cast headed by Yeoh. Watch for Jamie Lee Curtis as an IRS inspector. For that, Everything Everywhere All at Once gets 3.5 out of 4 Finding Oneself kisses. I'm Manny the Movie Guy for ABS-CBN News, and it's my pick of the week.
Oscar-winning actress Brie Larson is joining another well-known movie franchise. Hollywood superstar Vin Diesel officially welcomed Larson to Fast and Furious 10 through an Instagram post. Larson is best known for playing Captain Marvel in the Marvel Cinematic Universe. Fast and Furious 10 is slated to have a cinematic release in May of 2023. For more on this story, head on over to news.abs-cbn.com. And that'll do it for today. Thanks for joining us. I'm Carmina Constantino. If you want to revisit today's episode, you can play back this newscast on ANC's YouTube channel and on ANC 24/7 on Facebook. Keep safe. Keep it here on the news channel.
Mobility will be key to recovery because we have relaxed some of our quarantine methods, no? And we have allowed more transportation to come out. That's going to prove to be better for demand. If we do follow the health protocols, the ability of people to move around will likely contribute better to growth.